Back in February last year, preparations were well underway in Ukraine for an attack that seemed imminent.
Вітаю всіх, хто сьогодні разом з нами. 16 лютого в Україні день єднання.
There was a pilot broadcast on the 16th of February, and this was the date that Joe Biden predicted that Russia might invade Ukraine. This was when the TV channels first started broadcasting jointly in the TV marathon.
Western journalists too arrived in numbers to cover what was coming.
On the same day, Reuters actually had a live stream aimed at Ukraine's Independence Square, Maidan, in Kyiv, expecting the invasion to happen. It was perceived as very cynical.
Many people on the ground were still in denial.
Паніка нічим не допоможе.
А, ні, все нормально, чого бояться?
Та яка війна? Ми на танцях були.
A lot of people at the time didn't really believe that Russia would invade Ukraine. It was still regarded as some kind of media hysteria.
BBC Monitoring's media analyst Margarita Malyukova was watching it all unfolding right in her home country, Ukraine, as Russia waited another week before it launched a full-scale invasion of its neighbor on the 24th of February. Kyiv emerged defiant from the first wave of the assault, and the pilot program turned into a permanent fixture, the telemarathon. It was Ukraine's attempt to channel and distribute its news and information to a population under attack.
Ми здатні захистити нашу територію і нашу свободу. Ми єдині і незалежні.
The idea behind the marathon was that it would be easier to fight Russian disinformation. This is actually in line with Ukrainian law, which allows the government to exert more control over the media during the war. But critics say that the marathon has become a PR tool for the government.
In today's Global Jigsaw, we track the changes in Ukraine's broadcast media landscape since Russia's full-scale invasion. We examine the wartime constraints imposed on the media and ask, when does a slick PR campaign edge into propaganda? Also, once the media has adapted to the realities of war, what happens when peace returns? I'm Krassi, Twigg, and this is The Global Jigsaw, an original podcast from BBC Monitoring, zooming in on political, security and social shifts around the world through the lens of its media. Our team listens to, watches and analyzes media narratives in 100 languages.
Радіо Тегеран.
Right, we must go now to Moscow.
Ми не вторгались на територію України.
Western countries are not the international community. That era has finished.
In this episode, you'll hear from Yana Lushnevskaya, Margarita Malyukova and Sergei Arsentiev from BBC Monitoring, as well as Irena Taranyuk from BBC Ukrainian TV.
Вітаємо! Це марафон «Єдині новини».
Для вас працює команда телеканалу «Рада».
Тримаємо руку на пульсі.
Та підсумовуємо для вас.
The TV marathon, or telemarathon, as they call it in Ukrainian, is an unusual effort by a country with a diverse media environment to streamline its TV output down to one broadcast, aired across all channels. Margarita watched the process of this TV unification just before she was evacuated from her home.
Державу та наближають перемогу України. У студії каналу Рада Андрій Сініцин та Оля Бутко.
Наша команда підготувала підсумковий інформаційний.
Before the war, television was by far the biggest source of news in Ukraine. There were lots of TV channels owned by tycoons who had their own political interests and ambitions. So if you were exposed to a wide variety of viewpoints, often you would hear criticism of the government for various reasons. But with the start of the war, things have changed. The biggest commercial TV channels united and started broadcasting jointly. They now take turns to present the news during six-hour slots, and this became known as the TV marathon.
What was the thinking behind the creation of this TV marathon?
There was so much fake news going on, especially in the early days of the war, that it would be convenient just to have all the channels working together and prevent any kind of fake news. But another reason was that a lot of journalists were leaving the country, and it was just much easier to have the remaining staff work together.
Many colleagues from our Kyiv team also had to make a difficult choice, to leave or to follow their journalistic instinct under the bombs. Sergei Arsentiev was among them.
We even had a chance to go abroad when the U.S. embassy staff evacuated 2 days before the invasion. But we thought that the Americans were overreacting after Afghanistan, and we decided to stay a bit longer. And when the invasion started at 5 a.m, my wife is also a journalist, all our thoughts were to report urgent news, and we didn't think about ourselves. Well, as a result, when we decided to move later that day, it was too late, and men were not allowed to leave the country.
Russia's all-out attack on its independent neighbor changed the media landscape in an instant, as Margarita told me, with the launch of the telemarathon. Another long-standing member of Monitoring's Kyiv team, Yana Lushnevskaya, who moved to Poland after the start of the war, kept a close eye on how this unexpected project was received.
It was very unusual. In fact, some observers have called it a miracle. The coverage on different channels was rather diverse before the war, and why it was very unexpected for them to unite like this and to start speaking in this one single pro-Ukrainian voice.
Tell me a little bit about the content.
So we have news bulletins, we have presenters in the studio who speak to various guests, and those can be military spokesmen, MPs, army support volunteers, correspondents from across Ukraine. And there are also very practical things. For example, you can see QR codes on the screen. So you scan it and you can make a contribution, you know, you can contribute some money towards, for example, buying drones for the military.
Ми обрали свою країну. Вона обрала нас. Знищуємо ворога.
We hear a lot about Western military aid and donations from abroad, but many people may not realize that despite living in a war-ravaged economy, Ukrainians themselves have raised hundreds of millions of dollars to help the war effort. The telemarathon is likely to have played a significant role in that too.
There is plenty of advice. When an air raid siren goes off, for example, the presenters will encourage you to proceed to the bomb shelter. And there are very frequent reminders for the viewers to only trust official information, that is, from the government and the military.
385 днів наші захисники та захисниці героїчно боронять державу та наближають перемогу України.
There is a lot of emotive language on the marathon, and Ukraine is described as this unbreakable country. And let's just say that the presenters and reporters, they mince no words about Russian troops. They are described as invaders, occupiers, fascists. Sometimes they're even called
rushists,
which is a combination of Russian and fascist. And orcs is another common word to describe them.
Orcs as in the Tolkien
Lord of the Rings.
Lord
that's
of
right.
the Rings.
Yeah.
So plenty of patriotic content, but also language that dehumanizes the enemy. Let's park this for later when we return to the subject of propaganda. But to complete the picture on this unified TV broadcast where a different team takes over every 6 hours, how does it look on the screen? Margarita gave me the visuals.
The channels still work with their own studios, with their own staff. They are united by this logo of the TV marathon, but they still all look very different. Some of them operate on their regular set, others work from bomb shelters. You would have a very different experience depending on which channel is running the TV marathon at a particular point in time. They have different presenters, different journalists with different levels of experience. So it's a very diverse experience.
Who's paying for it?
A large portion of the funding does come from the government, and this is very different from what the situation used to be.
This throws up questions about how TV channels were selected to take part in the marathon. Were all the big players invited?
If you are Ukrainian, you will notice that some channels are conspicuously absent from this list. These are channels associated with former President Petro Poroshenko, who also happens to be Zelensky's biggest political opponent in the pro-European camp. Channels associated with Poroshenko complained that they actually wanted to join the TV marathon, but were not welcome there.
There was no official reason given. You are listening to The Global Jigsaw from BBC Monitoring. This feels like a good moment to find out how Ukraine's media worked and what restrictions it faced before the full-scale invasion. Irina Taranyuk, editor of BBC Ukrainian TV, has this fact file.
Ukraine had a vibrant and diverse media environment before the invasion in 2022, with popular TV channels like OnePlus1, ICTV, Suspilne, and a number of influential online outlets like Ukrainska Pravda or NV. Ukraine began to make attempts to limit Russia's media influence long before the invasion. The first such efforts came in 2014, the year Russia annexed Crimea and backed separatist forces in Donbass. Russian state TV channels were blocked first. At the time, they were already full of anti-Ukrainian propaganda, for example, suggesting that Ukraine was run by Nazis. Even the liberal TV channel Dozhd was blocked in 2017 for displaying a map of Russia, including Crimea. Access to popular Russian online platforms and social networks was also blocked, like Yandex, Russia's biggest search engine, ВКонтакте, similar to Facebook, the same year. But it's not just Russian media that fell victim to the ongoing information war. In 2021, three Ukrainian TV channels associated with Putin's ally, pro-Russian politician Viktor Medvedchuk, were also blocked. They were long accused of promoting the Kremlin's interests, and the move was attributed to national security. Press Freedom Campaign Group Reporters Without Borders condemned the ban, saying that even though the desire to combat propaganda is legitimate, it does not justify the use of censorship. Ukraine has also adopted legislation that led to the media increasingly switching to the Ukrainian language. For example, papers and magazines have been required to publish in Ukrainian from January 2022.
Europe's largest land offensive since World War II rumbles on with no end yet in sight. Jana's been across the statistics on whether the United TV channel continues to have an impact.
According to one survey carried out last year, almost all viewers in Ukraine know about the marathon and 32% watch it. And the majority of those who do watch it, they trust it. But the same survey showed that overall TV viewership was decreasing and Ukrainians were increasingly turning to the internet and social media for news. And this is understandable, of course, because almost all of the official information is first published online. So imagine if you're a resident of Kyiv, for example, and Kyiv has been under attack. Where would you get information about casualties, you know, the aftermath and the destruction? You would go to the Telegram channel of the Kyiv mayor, Vitaly Klitschko. And the marathon would also go there and report the news on the air. So if you're an audience member in Ukraine, you might as well just follow the mayor on Telegram without waiting for mainstream media to report it.
Audiences don't appreciate the delay in reporting news on TV, as Jana just described. But there are also restrictions on what can be reported during wartime. And this is where overt military censorship appears to be playing a significant role.
At the beginning of the war, there was a decree issued by the commander-in-chief of the army, Valery Zaluzhny. And under this decree, journalists are not allowed to say anything that can potentially hurt Ukraine's military operations. If they fail to do so, they could risk losing their accreditation. For example, in April 2022, a Ukrainian TV channel aired a report about a tank repair plant. It is said that this report helped Russia identify the coordinates of the plant and later helped Russia to bomb it.
The journalist in question continues to work for OnePlus1 channel, including reporting from the front line.
In November, some Ukrainian and foreign journalists were deprived of their accreditation because of their reporting from Kherson. The city had only recently been liberated by Ukrainian troops, and the Ukrainian military said that it was still not safe to do any reporting from there.
This is the announcement of the general staff about this concrete case. We voiced it up.
Recently, some media representatives, ignoring existing prohibitions and warnings, have carried out information activities in the city of Kherson without the consent of the relevant commanders and before the completion of stabilization measures. Such actions are a gross violation of the requirements of Order No. 73 of the Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces of Ukraine, dated 3rd of March, 2022.
In military speak, stabilization measures mean securing an area that's been retaken. Many journalists found it initially hard to adjust to working under military censorship. Sergei heard about it from colleagues.
Especially in the first few months after the invasion, most complained about restrictions on publishing reports and pictures and videos of Russian missile strikes and artillery strikes, because the defense ministry explicitly prohibited it. But some Telegram channels, for instance, or even state officials did that. The military just don't want to comment about anything. On the other hand, there are officials who understand that it's necessary to fill the so-called information vacuum, because otherwise it will be filled by Russian media and Russian Telegram channels.
But we got word of what later looked like a case of cooperation between the military and journalists to create an information blackout and pull off a distraction for tactical purposes. And it seemed to work.
And state officials and the army definitely used media for their purposes as well. For instance, they used mass media to fool the Russians before the operation to liberate the eastern part of Kharkiv region. Media widely publicized interviews by top officials and generals about plans to attack in the south, which persuaded the Russians to move their best units to southern Ukraine. And then Ukrainian troops took the opportunity and started the advance near Kharkiv and liberated the entire Kharkiv region then.
There might have been some cooperation between journalists and the authorities, but that is only one aspect of a complex relationship made trickier by martial law. Margarita has seen stories the authorities wouldn't have appreciated.
There isn't much criticism of the government on the TV marathon, but if you look online, the story is very different. There have been some major investigations on corruption by newspaper journalists. The biggest story by far was one about corruption in food procurement for the army. And this was such a big story that it led to a whole reshuffle in the government, with some senior officials being dismissed. For some time, there was a whole debate on social media. Some people argued that this is not a time to engage in these domestic arguments because this only hurts Ukraine's unity, and by doing so, it makes us look bad. But others argued that corruption should be in the spotlight even during the war, because what hurts Ukraine is not corruption itself, but a lack of response to corruption. Some argue that in the process of fighting Russia, Ukraine should not become Russia. Ukraine should not lose the values that it's fighting for, which include democracy and free speech.
Does that mean that nobody in Ukraine is immune from criticism?
It's not acceptable to criticize military strategy. There was a verbal request by the commander-in-chief addressed to bloggers and to journalists not to question Ukrainian military strategy, because this might hurt Ukraine and play into Russia's hands.
Don't question the strategy. That's not something they teach you in journalism school. But this is about journalism in exceptional circumstances, which have imposed a new set of rules. Yet it is often thanks to the journalistic impulse to question that gets us closer to the truth. Listen to this next story from the Kharkiv region.
Shortly after the region was retaken by Ukrainian troops, people found a box with golden dental crowns. Ukrainian officials immediately alleged that this was evidence of torture. But later on, some German journalists questioned this theory, and they found a doctor in this village who said that actually these were teeth that he had pulled from patients. He suggested that maybe the Russians thought these teeth were gold and therefore seized them, or maybe they used these teeth to intimidate. But he did not believe that this was any kind of evidence of torture.
This next example is a famous one, and it marked the beginning of what would later be praised as Ukraine's PR masterclass, the Ghost of Kyiv.
Ukrainian officials reported at the beginning of the war that there was this legendary pilot. He allegedly shot down 6 Russian warplanes on the first day of the war. Later, he was reported killed, and by that point, he had destroyed as many as 40 warplanes. This was such a remarkable story that it caught the attention of international media, And only after this, the Ukrainian Air Force was forced to admit that actually the pilot isn't a real person. He's just a collective image of all Ukrainian pilots who fight Russia.
Government officials shared footage from a video game, as well as a photo of the supposed flying ace. And some Western papers even claimed to have identified him. It may have been untrue, but the story served an important purpose, as Yana remembers.
I was still in Kyiv at that time, and I was so worried about my own safety, the safety of my family, the future of Ukraine. Will my city be occupied, you know? But then I remember, I think I was sitting in a bomb shelter, as was often the case in those early days. And I was reading this romantic story of some amazing, you know, hero pilot who was shooting down enemy warplanes above the capital. And I felt, I sort of know it's not true, but it made me feel better inside. It really raised my morale a little bit.
In a funny twist, the Ukrainian Air Force later issued a reminder to the population about the basic rules of what they called information hygiene and the importance of checking your sources. What followed were memes, myths, and PR galore. Some of it you sure will remember.
There was the very famous story of Snake Island when Ukrainian border guards resisted the potential Russian invasion of the island. And when one of the border guards issued a very famous slogan, telling the Russian warship to go to hell. And this slogan became so popular, it's all over the billboards in Ukraine. There are stamps issued with the slogan. It really became one of the memes of this war.
I remember we were following it on Twitter with bated breath, all the developments. Was it true?
The story was true. Some elements of it were not exactly true. For example, initially Ukrainian officials said that these border guards were killed. But it later transpired that they were taken captive by Russia and eventually returned to Ukraine in a prisoner exchange. But certainly the initial news that they were killed added a lot of drama to the story.
It was a happy ending in the end.
For sure.
And after returning home from captivity, the border guard was awarded a medal for his actions.
And another story is one of a Ukrainian grandmother allegedly downing a Russian drone using a jar of pickles. And there was some speculation about whether these were pickles or tomatoes in the jar, but the whole story appears to be apocryphal.
It's the kind of stories to keep the spirits high.
Exactly.
The war, it is often said, has strengthened Ukraine's national identity. And there's no better evidence for that than the language people choose to speak. Although the Ukrainian constitution guarantees free development, use and protection of Russian and other languages of national minorities, following earlier legislation, Russian stopped being a language of education.
We know from various opinion polls that the number of Russian speakers switching to the Ukrainian language is growing. For some of them, the switch began in 2014 when Putin pushed this idea of protecting Russian speakers abroad. And many Ukrainians, you know, did not want to be those Russian speakers who would come to be protected by Russian soldiers. And now people are switching to the Ukrainian language just to not to have anything in common with Russia. There are still many Russian speakers, obviously, but what is definitely clear is that being a Russian speaker does not mean being pro-Russian. So many Russian-speaking soldiers are fighting on the front lines. President Zelensky himself is originally a Russian speaker. His Ukrainian was not even that good when he just became president.
Has Zelensky's Ukrainian improved?
It has, a lot. I would say that the invasion made Ukrainians, I think, much more willing to accept further de-Russification, as it's called, of the public space in Ukraine. If you look at the media, for example, before the invasion, most of the press was published in Russian. So if you were a Ukrainian speaker and you wanted to read a magazine in Ukrainian, you would have to look hard to find one, to be honest. And now, yes, there are laws that made publishers switch to Ukrainian, but at the same time, there's also more like a grassroots initiative to use Ukrainian more.
One particular move in that direction attracted controversy outside the country, with some on social media comparing Ukraine to Russia in its approach.
There was a radical example when the Kyiv Mohyla Academy, which is one of the most famous universities in Ukraine, actually banned the use of Russian on campus. There are no real punishments for people who use Russian, but it's more of a cultural step, an encouragement, incitement for people, for students, to switch to Ukrainian.
You are listening to The Global Jigsaw from BBC Monitoring. The man behind Ukraine's remarkable resistance is now one of the most recognizable faces in the world, looking directly into the camera, dressed in his signature army green.
Ця ніч буде більш тяжкою, ніж день. Під ударом багатоміст нашої держави.
Володимир Зеленський has gone through quite a transformation. His image now is that of a heroic wartime leader.
Особливо увага Києву. Не можна втратити столицю.
He became a star. And this is, of course, due to the fact that he decided to stay in Ukraine when a lot of people thought he would leave the country. But it's also down to his communication strategy in general. Zelensky as an actor is very gifted at addressing his audience. He has these daily addresses to the nation, daily speeches that he gives to Ukrainians to inform them about what happened during the day and trying to lift their morale.
Всім добрий вечір. Прем'єр-міністр Шмигаль тут.
The first wartime message was a defiant proof of life. Zelensky shooting a selfie-style short. His team can be seen standing behind him. All of them with me here, he says, ready to defend the country's independence.
Слава нашим захисницям. Слава Україні.
Героям слава.
At the start of the war, those videos played a particularly important role because it showed that Zelensky is there, the government is there, they are in control of the country, and that basically everything will be okay.
Later, these messages became a world series, Zelensky addressing foreign leaders, parliaments, festivals, youth forums.
Come with Ukrainian symbols to support Ukraine, to support freedom, to support life.
On the anniversary of the invasion, he held a major news conference. He gives interviews to Ukrainian journalists, to Russian journalists, to Western journalists who can even visit him in his presidential compound. So that's an interesting contrast with Vladimir Putin, to whom journalists do not seem to have access, even though he's in a much safer city.
Greetings from Kyiv. We're just days away from the European Union's historic decision on Ukraine. Embrace Ukraine, strengthen Europe. Slava Ukraine.
Героям слава! Thank you so much, Mr. President.
And so arrived a procession of world leaders paying Zelensky visits in Kyiv, including an unprecedented visit by a sitting American president to a country at war, a diplomatic coup. This soundbite from Ukraine's foreign minister Dmytro Kuleba says it all.
Historically, Ukraine was unfairly underappreciated, and I regret it took a bloodshed and a devastating war for the world to realize how cool we are. And we were always cool, but it just took you too much time to realize that.
Ukraine now has a lot of admirers, as well as plenty of doubters. But what about Zelensky's appeal at home? Will it outlast the war?
This is a big question because even now people are asking questions of Zelensky, particularly of what happened before the war, whether or not Ukraine was well prepared for the invasion, whether or not people should have been warned more about the invasion potentially happening.
At what point did the positive spin and the masterful PR turn into propaganda? And is this something that is being scrutinized in Ukraine?
The propaganda appeared in the very first days of the war to lift people's spirits, but I would not say that it's very controversial in Ukraine, at least among regular Ukrainians. People really do believe that they need something to lift their spirits in such a difficult time. But certainly some journalists are raising this issue about truthful, reliable information, and they see the propaganda as a threat to Ukraine's credibility, both inside Ukraine and abroad.
Since the invasion, we have seen TV stations taken off air to make way for a new unified state-funded TV broadcast. We've seen military censorship of what can and cannot be reported. And there have been other attempts to rein in the media through legislation. Yana was across the legal developments.
One of such attempts came before the invasion, and it was the so-called anti-oligarch law. It was initiated by Zelensky maybe 1 year or so before the war started. That was one of his major post-election plans, to make sure that the tycoons don't have as much influence on the country. Oligarchs were to be included in a special register, and they would be forbidden to finance political parties, campaigns and rallies, and to privatize large state property. They are also required to declare their income. But critics said that it was actually more of a witch hunt against the president's opponents.
And what was the more general response from the public?
Well, let's say there were two casualties of the law. They were two very popular Ukrainian TV channels, Ukraina and Ukraina 24. They were owned by Ukraine's richest man, Rinat Akhmetov. They were fairly critical of Zelensky, and many suggested at the time that it was exactly because of the anti-oligarch law.
To recap, we've heard about two significant legal changes so far. First, the law restricting Russian language and pro-Russian broadcasting. Then the oligarchs' register, which weakened the media influence of powerful business owners. Yana also followed a third law with implications for media freedom, passed just a few months ago.
The Ukrainian MPs adopted a new law on media late last year, and adopting it was one of the requirements for the beginning of EU entry talks for Ukraine. One of the big changes it introduces is that it expands the powers of the main media regulator, the National Council for TV and Radio Broadcasting. For example, in addition to broadcast media, it now covers press and online. It also now has the right to impose sanctions on the media and even block them. Another big change is that the new law provides for some regulation of online media, and anonymous media, for example, will face particularly strict checks and potentially penalties.
And how was it received?
There was some praise. The press freedom NGO Reporters Without Borders welcomed the adoption of the law. It said that it specified many points that were previously missing from Ukrainian legislation, and that was a good thing. But at the same time, there is concern, both inside the country and internationally, about the independence of the regulator. So at the moment, half of the members of the council are appointed by the president and another half by parliament. And parliament is currently effectively under presidential control. The European Federation of Journalists in particular expressed concern. They said that it would give arbitrary and disproportionate regulatory powers to the national regulator. And this concern was echoed inside Ukraine by the Ukrainian National Union of Journalists.
What would happen to the media scene after the war?
There is definitely a debate going on. At the beginning of the war, there was this unspoken consensus that everyone should be united, everyone should speak in one voice, because Ukraine is known for like political disagreements and political bickering and lack of unity. But this time it's different because we're talking about the survival of Ukraine as a country. But at the same time, the explanation from the media is that Ukraine should not turn into Russia. It should have a diverse media environment. There is, in fact, space for critical journalism, even during wartime. Ukraine still has a rather thriving media landscape, especially for a country at war. So while there is concern, there is hope that Ukraine would be able, you know, to return to its pluralistic media environment. And there are reasons to be optimistic. Besides, Ukraine has a vibrant and rather influential civil society. So if there are any attempts to kind of pressure media freedom more after the war, there will definitely be pushback.
More than a year after the invasion, the idea that journalism is there to hold those in power to account is not drowned out by the noise of fighting in Ukraine. Thank you to Yana Lyushnevskaya, Margarita Malyukova, Sergei Arsentiev and Irena Taranyuk. The producers of The Global Jigsaw are Krista Satori and Lucy Bailey. Original music is by Pete Cunningham. Our studio engineer is Nigel Dix, and I'm Krassi Twigg. Stay with us a little longer if you can. Nearly a year and a half is gone since Russia's full-scale invasion of Ukraine, which uprooted and upended millions of lives, our colleagues amongst them. Let's go back to a moment in time that will stay with each one of them forever.
There was a heartbreaking part on the first day of the invasion when there was footage of tanks entering into, you know, what used to be Ukraine-controlled territory. And when I saw that, I think I just lost it, because I had just crossed that very same crossing point, I think a month before that, when I visited my family for Christmas. And now I saw those huge columns of Russian troops and hardware.
I suggested that my wife and my two kids leave without me, but they refused, and we decided to stay together. That was the moment I realized how much they love me and how much I love them. The emotional stress when you read all the stories about casualties, then you want to eat all the time something sweet, smothered in chocolate. There were many times I thought it couldn't get any worse. And then came the atrocities of Bucha and Irpin and then Izum. Reporting war crimes is the most difficult part of the job.
I vividly remember being on that bus that was going from Lviv to Poland, and I was crying. I was with my mother at the time, but my father remained in Ukraine, and I just didn't know whether I would ever see him again. And I really wish at the time that I had spent more time talking to him in person, that I didn't have all these silly arguments that I had with him. It really made me rethink my relationship with my family, with my friends. And if there's anything I learned from the war, it's that I should really value the people in my life, and that I just have no way of knowing when I can possibly lose them.